Thank you, sir. I'll share my screen now. Sir, is my screen visible?
Yeah.
Yes, yes, please carry on.
Yeah, thank you, sir. First of all, I'd like to thank Jaipur Ophthalmological Society, Dr. Vishal Agarwal, Dr. Indra Agarwal, and Dr. R.K. Sharma for giving me this opportunity. So I'll just start a brief introduction about optic pit, which is a small excavation of optic nerve head, and it's a very rare anomaly, not very common, in 1 in 10,000 eyes present, and it's due to incomplete closure of superior end of the embryonic fissure. Most of the pits are located temporal on the temporal edge of the optic disc, but some may be central. But closer the pit is to the margin of the optic nerve head, more are the chances of the associated maculopathy. And association of optic nerve pit with a central serous detachment is also called Cronenberg syndrome, and it is present in 40 to 50% of patients who have optic disc pit, and it could be inner layer or outer layer or both with the retinal stesis. So this is basically the pathophysiology of various theories have been given, but the most accepted nowadays theory is by Havel Linkoff, when he said that it is due to the vitreous fluid which enters the pit and causes an inner layer stesis, and inner layer stesis the fluid seeps into the outer layers causing a outer retinal detachment. So this is the theory which forms the basis of treatment of the optic disc pit with maculopathy nowadays. The principle lies just as the pathogenesis says, that there is an abnormal communication between the vitreous and the cerebrospinal fluid, and there's dynamic fluctuation in the gradient between the intraocular pressure and intracranial tension, which directs the movement of fluid. Any kind of vitreous traction over the pit is also responsible for opening of this communication, and the treatment requires elimination of this translaminar pressure gradient or closure of the pathway for fluid flow into the retina. So various options that are available are, first one is the green laser or the argon laser treatment. When one or several rows of laser were given between the serous detachment and the optic disc, and only to the elevated retina in the peripapillary area. But many studies have shown that there is no difference in treated and untreated eyes in which argon laser is used solely as a only treatment for the treatment of optic pit. So vitrectomy has been tried for this optic pit. First of all, we used to do vitrectomy with gas. Same vitrectomy with gas and laser combined, again at the edge of the optic disc. Nowadays, we generally do vitrectomy, gas, and we do internal limiting membrane peeling. Especially nowadays, we put a flap into the pit to close the communication that is existing between the vitreous fluid and the CSF. So this is a small demonstrative case how we do it. So this is a 16 years female. She had an optic nerve head pit with maculopathy. You can see a massive detachment of the retina below the foveal, below the fovea, involving the fovea now. And she had undergone a juxtapapillary laser, which was done elsewhere. And her best corrected vision at this stage was 36. So this is how we would do the surgery. First of all, we stain, we induce the PVD using intravitreous triamcinolone. We have to be very slow. These are very young patients, and the vitreous is tightly adherent to the retina. So we have to be very slow when we are inducing the PVD. Then we do an internal limiting membrane peeling. In this case, I have removed the whole of the ILM from arcade to arcade, sparing the juxtapapillary area from where the flaps are put inside the pit. And in this, in optic disc pit, unlike in macular holes where we have to stuff it quite hard, these flaps, they just get sucked into the pit. And then we do apply the laser around the optic disc in the elevated retina. In the end, we use gas as a tamponade. We can use both short acting, generally we use a short acting gas in these cases, like SF6. So this is 3 months post-operative, the same patient, although there is a small neurosensory detachment still persisting, but the fluid is almost gone and the vision has improved to 6/12. The pit is closed. So sometimes there will be a gliotic tissue, as in this patient, if you see the optic nerve head, there was a thin fibrous tissue overlying the optic disc pit, and this glioptic tissue needs to be removed, otherwise it will keep on causing traction at the optic disc pit. So this was a patient, he had vision of 6x60, and you see I'm removing here the glioptic tissue which is present over the pit. It is again quite adherent, and then proceed in the similar fashion, do a ILM peel, and the juxtapapillary flaps then are introduced into the pit. Again, do a fluid air exchange. Do some laser around the optic disc pit in the area of the elevated retina. This case I did just 15 days ago, and today only he showed me, came for follow-up. This is 2 weeks post-operative. The fluid, the outer retinal detachment has decreased, the schisis has decreased, and the patient's vision has improved to 6x18 after 2 weeks. But there is one problem which can occur in very chronic patients, and this was a 36-year-old female. She had a decrease of vision for 1 year, and she was treated elsewhere as central serous retinopathy for 1 year, and her best corrected vision had gone down to counting fingers at 2 meters only. In this patient, this is a quite 3-4 years ago, I had done this surgery. And again, in this patient, we started with the optic, the ILM peel. In this patient, I did a complete ILM peel. But in this patient, because of the chronicity, ideally, I should have done a fovea sparing ILM peel. But unfortunately, in this patient, I did a complete ILM peel. And this patient landed up with a post-operative macular hole. Though the fluid has decreased and the schisis has decreased, but there was a macular hole, and the vision, although it improved to 6x60, I offered the patient the second surgery, but the patient refused. He was happy with even with the 660 vision and was not willing to undergo the second surgery. But this, now we should keep this in mind that a chronic patients, this problem can occur. So nowadays we generally in these type of patients, we do a fovea sparing ILM peeling. This was again a 26-year-old female who with 6 months pregnancy, and she was being treated elsewhere as pregnancy induced CSR. And she had a best corrected vision of 6x36. On examination, there was a optic disc pit at the temporal edge, and there was a large detachment involving the macula. And this ILM peel, but we spared the fovea. You see, I'm raising the flaps from the outside towards the center, and I'm not touching the foveal area at all. And once I have done this, I'll just trim off these flaps, sparing the fovea. So with the cutter, I just trimmed off these flaps. The fovea was spared. Again, we had the juxtapapillary ILM flaps also. We stuffed them into the pit and then proceeded further with the fluid air exchange and laser. This case I did just before this corona lockdown started, and 15 days post-operatively, I had seen that patient. The fluid has decreased. I'm in touch with her on phone, and she said that she is feeling better now with time. So these are some more patients. We did the same way, and you see these patients, they all showed good improvement after this surgery. And again, this patient who had undergone laser earlier showed an improvement. Now coming to optic disc colobomas, which are again large discs with inferior excavation, again a rare condition, and it's usually sporadic and unilateral, and most of the cases present with decreased visual acuity. And sometimes this optic disc coloboma can also be associated with a pit inside the coloboma causing maculopathy. Like in this patient, there was a maculopathy with outer retinal detachment. And this patient was advised surgery at this stage, but she refused surgery at this time, and later on came with an increase in the fluid, and leading to almost subtotal retinal detachment. So now she was ready for surgery. We operated this patient again using triamcinolone. We induced the PVD, and we have to be very slow. The vitreous is very adherent at the coloboma edges and otherwise also. And if we are not careful, we may tear the retina. So you can see this is a communication between the vitreous and the subretinal space. The fluid was coming out. So in this patient also, we raised those juxtapapillary flaps and we stuffed these flaps into this pit and coloboma. And then did laser around the coloboma and around the optic disc coloboma and the associated choroidal coloboma also. Then we did a fluid air exchange, and then in the end we used C3F8 gas for the tamponade. And this is 6 months post-operative. The patient's vision had improved to 6/18. So this is another patient. This was done by my associate, Dr. Kamaljeet, and she did this case. So after removing the gliotic tissue and inducing the PVD, vitrectomy was completed. Again, some more glasses was seen, and then it was removed. A fluid air exchange was done. She did a retinotomy here. And in the end, oil was injected. So the only difference in this case was that we did not do a peripapillary laser in this time. And this again is sometimes is a very commonly reported problem. You can see here, there are some fish egg like things. These are some subretinal silicon oil bubbles, which have gone, the silicon oil has gone subretinal through the coloboma in these eyes. And this is again a very commonly reported misadventure which happens with these surgeries. So now, last coming to the morning glory syndrome. Again, you have a large disc with funnel shaped excavation and spoke-like vessels emerging from the disc. And there is an annulus of choroidal atrophy around this disc and multiple narrow and straightened retinal vessels. And again, there is a central tuft of white fiber overlying the disc. Though this is not a related case, but Vishal asked me to include this into the discussion. I'll just go briefly through this. So this was a 26-year-old male who presented with a morning glory optic disc, which showed contractions of the disc. So you can see the disc in all the three phases. You see there is a contracted phase of the disc when the disc is smaller, and after some time it just pulsates, it becomes larger and again very large, and you see the vessels are moving apart. This is the fluorescein angiogram of the same patient, and you see the vessels which are closer during the early phases have moved apart in the late phases. So this was and we have to take care. Whenever we see a morning glory syndrome, the diagnosis is so striking, the appearance is so striking that you suddenly make a diagnosis and then forget all about it. But just if you look carefully, so these anomalies can be having some variants like this. This morning glory disc with contractile phenomena, and I've seen three cases in overall of this kind of thing. And another variant of morning glory, again, it could be associated with maculopathy as we were discussing. And this patient, you see there is an outer retinal detachment again in this area. And this is a 12-year-old girl. She was again advised surgery, but they did not undergo surgery, came back later with a full-fledged retinal detachment. And then at that time, we did the surgery again. In this case also, we have to take care that we have to remove this glial tissue completely. And the when we for inducing the PVD also, we have to be very careful. We have to use the forceps in this case, remove the glial tissue and induce the PVD along with it. And then this glial tissue is very important. You have to remove completely. And once this is removed, then we created a retinotomy, a drainage retinotomy. The retina was flattened. The fluid air exchange was done. The laser was done around the disc and 360 degrees in this patient. And silicon oil was injected in the end. And this is 6 months post-operative after silicon oil removal. The patient's vision had improved and the retina was attached. So, to conclude, optic disc excavations with retinal detachment can be managed with good anatomical and functional results, and early treatment is always better for the best results. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. A lot of pits you have in your collection. So many.
Can I ask Sangeet a question?
Yeah, I think Sangeet, excellent video.
So you're not audible, sir?
Yes, Sangeet, audible or not?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. What I was asking was that do you have any visual criteria of opting a pit? Like below this, you will operate, and above this, you will not. Or any pit with megalopathy, Cranenberg syndrome, you will operate. Hello? Sangeet?
No, not yet.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. What I was asking was that do you have any visual criteria?
No, is there any visual criteria for you to operate? Opting a pit?
Actually, I'm not hearing your voice.
Vishal, are you hearing me?
But sir, aapki aa rahi hai.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Now, can you hear me?
We can hear you, Sangeet.
Sangeet, the question is, do you have any vision criteria for these patients for surgery?
So once there is a macropathy, I will operate with. Hello.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
Okay, sir.
Sangeet, the question is, do you have any vision criteria for
these?
हाँ हाँ ठीक है बोलो ये संगीत
सर एम आई
ऑडिबल यस सर यू आर ऑडिबल
यस
सर वी कैन कम टू डॉक्टर संगीत्स प्रेजेंटेशन क्वेश्चंस आफ्टर द नेक्स्ट प्रेजेंटेशन
ओके
कैन आई ऐड वन पॉइंट टू इट विशाल
यस सर प्लीज
यस सो आंसरिंग द क्वेश्चन आई लुक फॉर रीसेंट विजुअल लॉस रीसेंट मींस विजुअल लॉस ओवर वन ईयर इफ द पेशेंट इज गिविंग मी अ हिस्ट्री ऑफ विजुअल लॉस ओवर वन ईयर देन आई एम एबल टू प्रोग्नोस्टिकेट द केस बेटर सेकेंडली इज अ पॉइंट दैट In my first six cases, I had done non-foveal sparing peel and I had macular holes in two patients. So what now I've started doing is using Professor Morta's envelope peel. So one flap goes onto the pit and four small flaps come onto the thinned out fovea so as to fortify it. And I have seen that really helps. After that, I have done about seven more cases, and I have not had in any patient a formation of a macular hole. So it's like a fortification, and the visual result has been fair, but one has to give these patients at least 4 to 6 months for vision to gain the maximum. I have never used laser across the maculopapular one.
Absolutely. I think you see the peel across the fovea is risky. In fact, it has to be multi-layered flap, and one flap only goes into the optic pit. And I agree.
Can I add one point?
Yes, Vishal.
So besides everything, I agree on. But lasering around the pit, I've long left. It will be a little more destructive, and lasering at the papillomacular bundle can I have visual effects after the surgery.
Vishal
Mortada
wants to make a comment.
Sure.
Dr. Mortada, your words.
Yes. Excellent presentation, Sangeet. But I'm really afraid of creating a macular hole in these cases. Yes. Although the incidence is low, but why not to peel the ILM over the fovea if there is any risk of inducing a macular hole. So what I'm doing now is fovea sparing, ILM peeling or I start peeling nasal to the fovea and use the ILM to stuff it into the pit. So I do not cross over the fovea, and in this way, you may reduce the risk of creating a macular hole. This is the first comment. For the morning glory syndrome, these are really difficult cases. And in large morning glory syndrome, large defect, one has to be very cautious because you may create breaks inside the globoma while dissecting the glial tissue inside the globoma. So if this happens of creating a hole inside the globoma, you are really in a very difficult situation. And the only way to close the hole inside the globoma is to use a graft. And I prefer the use of the amniotic membrane graft to cover a break inside the globoma in morning glory syndrome. I don't like to use silicone oil in the morning glory syndrome because there is risk of the silicone oil migrating into the brain. And there are cases reported in the literature of silicone oil migrating into the brain. So in large defects of the optic nerve in morning glory syndrome, I usually use gas, and I don't prefer to use silicone oil. These are my comments. So you have to take measures to guard against creating macular hole by fovea sparing, ILM peeling, or peeling nasal. And then you have to put the ILM inside the globoma, inside the pit. And for this reason, I usually use the 41 gauge cannula to push the ILM inside the defect or the pit. And in this way, you are sure that it is inside the pit. So these are my comments.
Thank you.
I think that was wonderful, this thing. But do you laser or not? Because laser was one controversial thing, a lot of people, most of us don't.
Yeah.
No, I don't do laser because if you close the way transmitting the fluid by closing the pit, then you don't have to do laser.
Yeah.
So you have to close the pit, and you have to close it with the use of the ILM. And if it is large, you may use the amniotic membrane flap.
Yeah. So we all agree that it has to be a foveal sparing ILM. We all agree that something has to be used to close the pit, whether it is a nasal, this ILM flap, or amniotic, or some people have used lateral graft also, and a lot of tissues with it, and use gas only. There's no need of any laser to the papillomacular bundle, as Vishal was saying.